so much for coming to my session. I have to say I'm really thrilled that 13 people have come. I was talking to somebody in the refreshment area and she said she did a talk yesterday and only one person came.
Oh, that's a shame.
Yes, and I was thinking, that's going to be me, isn't it? That's going to be me. I'm Paul Carney. I am a teacher of 20 years and more in the UK. I've taught across different subject areas, predominantly within the arts, but also in maths and other areas such as technology and ICT. For the last 5 years, I've been working as a consultant, just going around the UK, visiting schools and helping them improve their education services. My field, I guess, that I'm passionate about is creativity. And we'll talk about that this morning and why I think it's really important and how you might embed it in your practice when you go back to schools. That noise.
That's why I say so. Close the windows.
Okay, well, if you could, that would probably possibly help. I'll start with this slide, which was written by the famous scientist William Lipscomb. And it was written in the 60s. And I would like to ask you, as teachers of science, whether you think that has changed. Whether you think, oh, this is an old sentence. We now do lots of aesthetics. We teach our children how to think in original ways as a result of their curriculum. If you do, you can breathe a sigh of relief and probably go to another classroom to find another course. I don't think it is, and I'll explain why. This is what I'm passionate about, creativity. And it is much maligned at this in education at this point in time. The current UK government, the current thinking in the UK is that we need to move towards a knowledge-rich model of education, and that creativity is too vague, it can't be defined, it's too woolly, it's not conducive to good learning. And I would just like to point out that if you just look up the word creativity and what it means, it says the use of imagination or original ideas to create something, inventiveness. Now I'd ask you, do you want your students to be able to actually do that? Is that something you think is a worthy act? Attribute of a kind of human being. If you just play with those words, use of imagination, well, use can be application of imagination, and ideas can as pretty much all not knowledge. So creativity is really just applying the knowledge that you teach to come up with original things. So it's just knowledge in action. It's doing stuff with the things we actually learn. And I'd argue there's a lot of worth in that. A lot of research being done on creativity. There's a lot of differences of opinion. But essentially, I prefer this model, or an either 2C model or a 4C model of creativity, where you have the lowest level as mini C with my little balloon dog there, as just meaningful experiences, actions, and insights. Those are those creative people, maybe like myself, who maybe like to go out and paint and draw and do hobbies and crafts, etc., and wear crazy clothes, and are generally very creative people. Up from that, we've got everyday problem solving. If you are trying to redecorate your room, or you're trying to find a new route to get to work that avoids certain locations, you're coming up with something new. You're trying to invent something new. If you're building, if you're a bricklayer and you're building a new and interesting feature, you're being creative in a problem-solving way. After that, we've got professionals, maybe people who have dedicated their lives towards research. yeah? And at the top, we've got creativity that alters the domain, not knowledge. And this changes according to the field you're working in. Each domain has its own set of creative rules. And there are gatekeepers to each one. So that there are gatekeepers in science who peer review papers. We have learned in institutions. And if I was to come up with a new idea, they would scrutinize that and say, it doesn't work. Or yes, oh wow, we really like this. And you know the creative breakthroughs that alter the way we think. In pop music, those rules are more flexible. The demand in pop music is for innovation. It's for fashion. It's for something new. It's a new sound. And so you don't need the expertise as much in pop music as you do to make a breakthrough in science. So whatever creative field you're working in, there's different rules, yeah? Currently in education, we're at this model, I think. And we have this huge mincing machine called our brains, and we put stuff into it. And if we put things into it, we believe more creativity will automatically come out of that. Well, if you look at the amount of creative innovation in the world by the number of published papers that are accepted and peer reviewed, and the number of creative breakthroughs compared to the amount of investment and money and resources going at the top to universities and funding across the world, I would argue there's a huge amount going in and a small amount coming out. Maybe at a ratio of 10 to 1. And actually, there's been some research done on this where if you look at a graph of the amount of money going into science over the last 50 years, it's gone like that. But if you look at the amount of peer-reviewed papers of innovations, it's like that. And it's a slight incline. So we're putting a lot more in, we're getting a lot less out. And why is that? That's because I don't think we teach people what innovation is, what it looks like. If I was to ask you, what do you think it is? And what leads to you coming out with creative outcomes? I assume you're all very kind of knowledgeable people. You're very expert in your field. And ask yourself, do the people making the creative breakthroughs, are they the most knowledgeable people? If I rise through the ranks and become the most eminent professor in a university, does that mean I'm also the most creative? No, it doesn't, does it? So increasing knowledge doesn't make me creative. There's something else going on. And I just want to look a little bit about how innovation works in science. So this is a graph where I'm mapping creativity or innovation down the left-hand side against not knowledge. At the top, we have a dotted line where there are those big C creative breakthroughs that change the domain of science, discovery of DNA, something like that. And at the bottom, we have the creative people like me who draw pictures of kind of squirrels and cats. Knowledge, I would argue, can be concrete at one end. This is not me that's saying that, this is how knowledge is organized. From concrete at one end to abstract knowledge at the other. Now, I would say school science education is more down this end. And because the theory is we can't invent anything unless we have a base, not knowledge. And I would agree with that. We can make breakthroughs. You can be a creative scientist by completely staying in that field, by building on other people's insights, shoulders of giants, all that gradually moving towards more insight, until you make a breakthrough. That's a successful wave, and it is. A dogged, methodical approach that's used a lot. At this end, the abstract end, is something that is a bit, it's a bit unknown, it's a bit vague, it's a bit out there, it's a bit like, not really sure what that is. What does that look like in the science lab? And so let's have a look.
Creativity you're talking about is the creativity you use as a professional.
So creativity is my definition, or definitions that I've learned from other people, comes in different forms. Creativity at the top end, with a capital C, is something that's so important it changes the domain rules, like we discover that DNA is a helix. It's so important, that piece of information, it changes all of science.
Okay.
That's at the higher end.
The creativity, your meaning is the creativity having impact on a field.
I'm talking about both. So I'm talking about that as, if you think of the number of people who will make that kind of breakthrough, it's probably 0.001% of everybody in the scientific field. So it's a tiny amount of people, probably nobody in this room will ever be able to make that kind of impact.
And
there's a big question around the word originality, because remember, creativity is coming up with new and original things. But in our world, in a young person's world, that creativity is simply coming up with things that are original to ourselves. So if I come up with something that I didn't know and I've discovered, then I'm advancing my own personal knowledge. If I keep going down that road and I know what originality is and I keep working in that way, I'm more likely to make a breakthrough.
It's also about stealing, I think. Stealing idea and make it your own and develop it, I think.
And I'm pleased you use the word steal, because that's important. In art, we don't borrow other people's ideas, we steal them. Because if you borrow an idea, you're copying it. But if you steal it, you take it, you make it yours, you do something new with it.
Mm.
Okay? So, there's been lots of research done on how innovation occurs in science. This was some good work in Greece in 2012, and some work in 2007 by Kind and Kind. And they talked about innovation in science needs curiosity, motivation. It's written in the open. And then when I study the science curriculum and I look for innovation and creativity, it's always in the national curriculum in England, it's in the opening sentence of every subject. In every opening sentence, it says things like, we want children to have the wonder and excitement of science and pursue it. And then it never mentions it again. And somehow it's just supposed to magically appear from what we teach. And it doesn't. So we need that inspiration. We need curiosity. We need wonder. We need that. And I would never advocate against a strong knowledge base. It's vital. It's important. I'm not a scientist. I don't have the knowledge base you've got, so I couldn't make any innovation in your field until I learn it and master it. So there's an acceptance from me that you need to know things. But, as I've said, it's not enough on its own.
But you wouldn't recognize it.
Mm.
Yes, exactly. And I wouldn't know what it was.
No.
And indeed, that's happened, hasn't it? It happened with discovering elements in the 18th century, I think, in Sweden. There was a guy in Sweden who discovered most of the chemical elements long before anybody had formally kind of recognized them. And it was maybe 50 years later, they were formally put down. And then he went, oh, hang on, I've got done this years ago, because he didn't know what he'd actually found. So that happens a lot. We develop theories in small steps. We need imagination. We blend creative processes with logical, rational processes. So we're back to this model. The logic and rational at one end, and the creative, imaginative at the other. And I would argue that scientists flick between the two ends. They move from the logical and rational to the speculative and back again. Much more than a mathematician might, I would say. Because at the initial stage, you need imagination, you need creativity, you need to speculate, you need to hypothesize, you're divergent thinking, and then you have to think convergently to bring that all back in. So you need two skill sets. But many scientists are at both ends. There's some very imaginative scientists who don't have that rigor, and there's some very rigorous scientists who don't have the imagination. I would argue that, do you even mention these? Are they something you mention in part of your teaching? On your desks, there's some handouts. If you don't have one, I've got some spares here. Because I
Thank you.
If there's any other ones.
Thank you.
I wrote a book called Drawing Science. And in it, I spent quite a few years researching how innovation occurs in science. And I was looking at it very much from a non-specialist's viewpoint. That's my book. It's available in the ASE bookshop, or from me, if you want it. And my book outlines those nine processes. And when I've researched the history of science and how innovation occurs, I found that innovation occurs through observation. And I don't just mean the artistic observation, I mean observation in the scientific sense of analysing, of studying, of gathering data. Science occurs through collaboration. And I would say most science today is done via huge groups. There's not many solo individuals making innovative breakthroughs in science anymore. It's big business. You need to work as part of a team. Knowledge. Somebody has an insight, makes a breakthrough. Adaptation. Adaptation is really taking one thing and applying it in a different place. So it's a metaphor, really. Kind of metaphor is used extensively in language across the world, and a metaphor is taking one thing and putting it somewhere else. And scientists do this all the time. So they will take the properties of those sticky buds that get stuck on your clothes, and that was used to invent Velcro. And so this kind of innovation happens all the time. Trial and error. The process of just doing something, it was done, mutual induction was invented in this way, the incandescent light bulb was invented in this way, Thomas Edison tried out thousands of different materials until he discovered that bamboo burned better than anything else he could find. And the first light bulbs used bamboo. And then it was, of course, replaced by tungsten, I believe. Serendipity plays a big part. Chance. So you're thinking of cosmic background radiation, penicillin, things like that, chance discoveries.
Sticky notes.
Yeah. Microwaves. The guy had a chocolate bar in his pocket in the lab, and he walked in front of a microwave machine, and suddenly his chocolate bar melted, and he thought, ooh, maybe I could use this. Alternative viewpoints, where you problem solve by looking at things from different angles. The dogged methodical approaches of classifying and visualization. I'd argue the last one's a really important scientific tool, and I picked up some scientific books from Best, and it uses the word visualization again and again and again. There's a lot of research, a lot of scientific research being done on visualization, and I would argue it's a really important tool that humans use all the time to imagine what might happen if I did this. If I lit that, what would happen? And I don't need to kind of light it, because I've played it out in my head, and if I light that, it's going to explode and probably kill me. And that type of intelligence is something you need in the science labs all the time. Now, there's some of that embedded in general intelligence. So there's evidence to say that human beings, when they're born, have a general intellect, and that doesn't change throughout their lives. It's fixed. And it doesn't matter how much schooling or exams a person passes, their intelligence will be fixed throughout their life. And all you can do as a teacher is alter the amount of stuff they actually know, but their general intelligence won't change. And I do believe visualization is linked to that. There is some people who can visualize things in their brains without being taught. I found this really strange. Let me see if I can do this as an experiment now. I don't even need to close my eyes. I could imagine now, just by staring out that window and staring at that wall, I could imagine an ocean. And there, a huge cube rises out of the ocean. I can see all the water dripping off it and a huge roar. Then I'm watching the cube come up in the air and start to spin. And then I can see that cube fly off in different places. Could you do that? Have a go now. See if you can visualize.
I was visualizing it while she was saying it.
Yes. Weird.
Yeah.
Anybody not be able to kind of do that?
One. I gave it red, but I don't know what colour.
Mine was blue.
Oh, there you go. See, what does that tell you? I don't know. Let's go deep.
Yeah, let's go deep.
No.
Because some people can't do that. There are lots of people out there. I did this as an experiment on Twitter, and the mathematician off the telly, Hannah Fry, retweeted it. And I had loads of responses from people saying, oh my God, I am totally freaked out. I cannot even begin to imagine that. Now, that doesn't mean to say you can't be a creative scientist, because you can. It just means that there are some aspects of science that you would find harder than other people. And so when you're asking somebody to predict a sequence in science, what will happen next, some people will naturally be able to do that better than others. But how do you teach it? Do you need to teach it? Probably not to pass a GCSE. Maybe, I don't know. However, I want to point, before we move on, I just need to check the time. What time have we got, anybody?
Yeah, it's your little
time. Right, okay, but I'm promising we're going to do some kind of drawing in a second. But I just wanted to say, I was feeling a little bit like an imposter. I was sat downstairs and I thought, what on earth am I doing here with all you people who know so much more than I do? And I was reading this book, this Best, that came in free in my pack. And I just thought, oh yeah, like I didn't know this. It's an experiment, you probably do, of the digestive system. And it shows you how a sock and a ball in a sock could illustrate the digestive system, and the stripes on the sock represent the muscles of the digestive tract, and that you illustrate that if you squeeze it along the stripes, the ball will move, and that's how food moves through our digestive system. And I thought, oh wow, that's really good. And then it went on to the respiratory system, and then it went on to the skeletal system, and it just bypassed it. And I thought, whoa, hang on a minute, stop right there. That's really cool. That is something I want to learn more about. That I want to, and this comes back to, are you there to just teach people to know things? And if you are, then great, you can kind of carry on. But if you want people to be creative scientists and innovative scientists, there is an opportunity there that you've missed. Because I might say to myself, I might challenge my students, how might you use that process for something else if we use an adaptation method? And that might be a question that I ask. What could you use this for? It's always hard. They always get this kind of tumbleweeds going through classrooms whenever I ask any teachers to come up with anything imaginative. And children are the same. And it's a terrifying thing of kids looking back at you going, what are you talking about? Think about it. We have pipes. And we can squeeze things and move something through it. In what ways might we apply that to the world, to invent, to create something? Here's what I thought, something mad. Oh, sorry, were you going to say something there?
Well, it's already invented, but I instantly thought about a tennis ball. Like a tennis That's ball. Really so you weird. You could play tennis by yourself. Well. It could squeeze up electronically,
yeah.
And you could do tennis by yourself.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Is it the ball in there? Is that why
we're thinking? I think that's why I went that way.
That's a little bit strange. Tennis ball, definitely. No, that's really good. So you might think, I thought, maybe you could have a machine. At one end, I'll put a vacuum that sucks up clothes off my bedroom floor, sucks them into the tube, and then moves them to a kind of wash basket.
Genius.
Isn't it?
My husband always puts the towel on top of the wash basket. Why not in the wash basket?
Exactly.
What is that about?
Exactly. So we could do that. So there's some fun. Remember back to our graph. There's those abstract thinking methods. That's fun. That's wild. But there's also, I thought, maybe you could use that in the food industry for recycling, composting food. Mm. That people put the food into a waste basket and some pipes could take it and filter it off. Don't know.
See, the only thing that I'm now thinking though that would worry me is the students remember that and then don't remember, you know, the bit that you need them to remember for exams. That's
how deep you're going.
I know.
You're asking them how are they.
Yeah, so it's only those children who really understand the concept of how that works that will be able to hold on to that and then, be able to apply it. But it's just, I worry those who haven't grasped the concept would then just remember the amazing machine.
I think you are.
I've got some of mine that, sorry. No, but some of mine that would remember it because it's different. Sorry, I think it can go both ways. I think I've got children that would remember it because of thinking about it as a machine for your clothes. They would remember the kind of process.
And all I'm advocating is that was just something I picked at random from reading a science book, thinking, I don't know anything about this. How can I teach these people anything? Thinking, whoa, that's really cool. And all I'm saying is, you might only do this once or twice a year at key moments with key processes. You know, those key big pieces of kind of knowledge in science that really underpin a lot of what you want children to actually learn. You might only use it then. And you really want to do it where there's a lot of flexible outcomes. And I could easily do this by saying, first of all, if I wanted to do this as a creative person, I need to use some of this. Because I need to watch a YouTube kind of video of how that works, a film of how it's moved. Because I thought, Is the digestive tract acting as a kind of Mexican wave type thing, where it's going in a sequence? Or is it where it knows where the food is and it's just squeezing where the food is? And that's a different mechanical process. And if so, how does it know where the food is? So that's leading me to a much deeper understanding about how it actually does it. And then I want to think, can I build it? Can I build one of them? What would I need to build one? Piece of paper.
Sock.
A sock. Start with a sock, start with a tennis ball. What could I use as constricting bands to put round the sock? What would squeeze them? What would open them? I need electronics. And the electronics would replace the veins. I'm just trying to open your minds a little bit to get you to see that this sock and the digestive system can catapult me off into a real imaginative world of thinking and problem solving and applying the science to real world situations. You don't have to make it. But I would argue that what you were saying, when they come to have to remember it for an exam, I would say that their understanding is much deeper, it's much richer. They know about the contraction of the muscles, they know how they ripple, they know how the signal is sent along their muscles. That's what I'm saying. So, my 9 processes in my book, I would argue they fit along your innovation like that. I think at one end, you've got rigid processes such as observation that are very concrete. You can't afford to get that wrong with observation. You've got to be tight. You've got to be exact. Methodical approaches where you're wading through huge amounts of data, and a lot of science is that in labs. It's dull. It's just wading through tons of data and picking out little anomalies and then finding out how to present that information.
That's being creative though, isn't it?
Yes.
Because you're having to, I think problem solving is, I think this, when I went to the Wellcome Trust in summer, they said something really interesting that they like the term STEM and not STEAM, because they think that the arts part is, it's just integrated into STEM anyway, because you can't be a scientist without being creative. That was their argument.
I would agree to some extent with that. My only problem is when I look at STEM education from an artistic point of view, I don't see the thinking methods I taught in art, I don't see them being used in the kind of scientific world very much. And yet, if you look at the history of all the Nobel Prize winners there's ever been, about the research has shown about 75% of them did an artistic pursuit, even semi-professionally. They were either artists, musicians, sculptors. Einstein was a violinist. You know, there's a big relationship between great scientists and artistic pursuits. I haven't made any of this up, by the way. There's a couple of great books that I absolutely love that I've based a lot of my theories on. One of them is by Robert Root Bernstein, Robert and Michelle Root Bernstein, his wife, called 13, it's called Sparks of Genius, 13 Thinking Tools of the World's Most Creative Minds. And it's very much studying how scientists innovate. He had 13, I've got 9. And there's another book out at the moment by Andreas Wagner, who's probably the most eminent evolutionary biologist living today, who's come up with some of the most incredible research in Switzerland on how life innovates, how organisms and cells can combine to make new forms. And it's a staggering book, loads of science, and it took me a long time to kind of read it. And he talks about a lot of these processes. Yeah. So it's very well researched. If you put any of those search engines in Google Scholar, any of those terms in Google Scholar, you'll find research done on all of them. even serendipity. There's been a lot of research done on that. So a few, let's do some drawing. How many people can draw? Put your hand up if you think you can draw.
You'll be able to guess.
Yeah, you can make a drawing, yeah.
You might not know what it is. What looks in my head is not how it looks on paper.
How many people would be brave enough to say, I don't think I can draw, I'm not very good?
But I like to do it, but I don't.
Interestingly, nobody put a hand up for I can draw.
Well,
three people.
You can ask. Can everybody write?
Exactly. My point exactly. You must have heard one of my previous lectures. That's all that is.
Sorry.
So we draw when we write, and writing is drawing. The same shape. I mean, writing came along a lot later than kind of drawing. Writing is a symbolic code system that uses simple geometric shapes, such as circles, squares, and rectangles, to create letter forms. And those same circles, squares, and rectangles are the geometry of the world we see. Everything in our world is made up of circles, squares, and rectangles, as Paul Cézanne said in 1895. And we use drawing as a tool, as a thinking tool. Even if we can't draw, we'll draw a diagram to explain something. If we want to tell somebody how to get somewhere, we can see you go down there and you go down the road, or you can draw them a diagram on a beam mat. Or if you're an anatomist and you want to explain how something works, you might do a little doodle. And people think, oh, well, that's not kind of drawing. But it is. Mm. It really is drawing. Which is next? I'm going to show you how to demonstrate the process of trial and error through drawing. So you need a piece of paper and a pen or pencil. Pen's better. Just use the back of one of the handouts.
Oh.
Can someone keep me aware of the time, please?
It's just behind you. Yeah, we can see it.
Right, I'm going to show you a picture of a car. Yeah. You've got to study this picture for 60 seconds.
No.
And you're not allowed to draw it. You've just got to look at the picture.
Okay.
Right? No cheating.
Oh, no.
So look at the picture of the car. You're going to draw it. And I'm going to turn the picture off. And you're going to draw it from memory. It's a good demonstration of our working memories, of how much, let's say, working memories about 30 seconds, what you've done in the last 30 seconds, about. And this is a good test of that. How much is going to go into long term memory for retrieval?
It might be in my head, it might not be.
How much can you retrieve? I'm not looking for skill of your drawings.
Okay. It's just
I'm only looking for the information you've recorded.
Okay, that might be okay then.
Right, okay. Now draw the car. Great demonstration of how little information we're able to retrieve. Because your brain is saying, it's drawing on everything you know about cars. You know cars have windows and wheels. But if I showed you were totally abstract, that you didn't have any reference for, it would be even harder.
I'm leaving them. That's a step far, isn't it?
Oh, she's a scientist. That's a scientist, isn't it?
Mine's fine.
You all finished?
No. Any colours and so on? Green and red.
I expect you to put shading on it and I expect it to
see,
be
I'm just labeling
mathematically
it.
Measured. I don't, I'm kidding.
Draw it the other way.
Yeah.
Oh, this is nice.
I was trying to do 3D.
Pens down, you're all allowed to draw now. Pens down and have a look at the car again.
It's
compare your drawing to the actual photograph. What did you get right? What did you get wrong? How many?
I missed off the red there. But I put
here, but I haven't colored it yet.
How many people did not get four exhaust pipes? How many people didn't remember four exhaust pipes? How many people wrote the name of the car?
I did.
No.
I did.
Important.
Well done. You got four exhaust. I saw you. You got four exhaust pipes and the name of the car, which is excellent. Lots of people wouldn't remember the picture.
No, I didn't.
No,
which is
I did something. Yeah,
green
flowers or whatever. What is it?
Lots of people wouldn't notice this. The Hot Wheels logo.
No, I haven't noticed.
The exhaust. This suspension here. Lots of people don't. Remember the patterns on the tyres or the shape of the alloy wheels, all important details. You did take a look at it. How many windows did the car have?
One.
Two.
Only one.
And one at the front.
One
That's two then, isn't it?
Three.
Yeah, but I didn't
visualize
3D.
Would there be one at the back?
Then it would be four.
But you couldn't see.
Yeah, I agree. I'm with you. I just drew one of my pictures. But there was
two. Because I made.
So now try and improve your drawing. You've just looked at the car again, so now go back to it. This is trial and error.
Give me five.
So now go back and add the alloy wheel patterns.
Yeah, and the hot
wheel. The tyre patterns.
Yeah, but I can't draw 3D. I've not got the skill.
You don't need the skill, I just need the detail.
And a grave digger here.
Well, it's just literally going to be. But I can't do that. That's going to look silly. It's like these.
Here also a window.
See how hard it is? See how much you forget instantly? Our brains don't remember things it doesn't deem worthy enough to remember. It just, your brain said to you, this is a car. I don't need to know any more than it is a car. What I do with pupils is I'll do it multiple times and get them to draw in different coloured inks each time. And I talk to them about the powers of observation, the powers of seeing and recording information, and how easy it is for us to miss things. We think we've seen something and we haven't. And this tool is something an artist develops a lot. And it's something that's useful for a scientist, particularly if you're working in certain fields. Archaeology comes to mind, the natural sciences, where you needed to record information quickly. Yeah. So,
I think this is very interesting because I often use drawing in my class, but then I don't go and let them do it better. Yes.
Yes. Mm. So it is about that thing of correcting our mistakes, putting what we've got wrong or what we've missed and going back to it. And if you want people to observe things, that's really important. Okay. A car is going to be in your mind, isn't it? Another exercise I do, which is, we're not going to do this. But it's a great exercise to do with your class next week. You just say to them, can you draw your front door, please? How long have you lived in your house? How many times have you walked into your front door? How many times do you look at that door in a day? Twice, three, four times?
Yeah, it's dark. For mine.
To be fair,
we don't have an external light on the house.
But I couldn't even remember what shape the handle was. I couldn't remember whether it was a six-panel door or whether it was an oval. I thought, I'm sure it's got stained glass in, but I can't quite remember. I can remember it was rectangular and it was number 65, and that was about it. And that teaches the students how your brains work. Your brains take shortcuts. Your brains are lazy. Your brains don't want to remember everything. Your brains want to do the most efficient, most cost-effective way of processing information. There's a lot of research to say that this idea you've got of an unconscious mind doesn't even exist. We're just making decisions all the time based on what we know, what we can recall.
So it's changed everything. It's changed every time. Because you're learning every time.
Yes. Yeah. So I'm going to do this next experiment now, which when you're teaching science, when I came to science and I looked at it and I thought, whoa, knowledge in science is really weird. Because in maths, there's a fact. But in science, when you deal with proofs and facts, you don't really deal with facts and proofs as such. Things are empirical. And how do I understand that if I'm 10 or I'm 14? How can I get my head around the way knowledge is different in science? And so let's look at the drawing of my house. And I want you to draw on a piece of paper my house. But I don't want you to draw the front of my house. I want you to draw the back of my house. So using the information you've got, can you hypothesize as to what the back of my house might look like?
Now?
Now, yeah.
So you're not going to take the picture away this time?
No, I'm not going to, no. So the first thing we do is to add lines of certainty. Which lines are you really certain about? What are your confidence? And in science, we talk about things we've got a high degree of confidence about. So which information do you have a high degree of confidence about?
The root and you're still there.
And then which lines are speculative? You could use different colours if you were working in a classroom. You can just take, a great one for this is to take photos from estate agents' websites, but I couldn't do that for copyright reasons. So I thought, okay, I'll use my own house. And I have learned one thing today, walking through Reading, that if my house was here in Reading, I could not afford it in a zillion years. Average house price in Reading is 450,000.
It's like, what?
See how you're doing. So you know there's windows at the back, you know there's doors, you should know there's drain pipes. Where would they be in the house? Can you get any indication? You should know what the roof tiles look like. You should have a chimney. But you can talk about things you don't know. You don't know whether I've had a conservatory fitted. You don't know the exact location and size of the windows, but you can get an indication of the design of the windows. You can get an indication what the design of the back door might be. So you can talk about things you know and things you don't know, and why don't you know them? And this is a really important method in science of thinking. I'm going to put you out of your misery a little bit now. So I'm going to give you some further information. So if you could share that with your colleague about my house. Please don't judge.
Look at this.
He did.
Yeah.
Mine was very much more factual.
Yeah. But it's for a bathroom, it could be one of them.
I've
got a side window.
Yeah. A little door that was at the bottom. How do we know where the bathroom is then?
Exactly. Exactly. So
I mean,
I'm not getting
the upstairs,
all the information.
Yeah.
I'd imagine.
I can just turn that into.
That's like a kitchen looking out the back.
So where would that
with a door. You see? There's a door.
Oh,
there.
That's a door, yes.
So
would sit on mine, the window would have to be closer to the door. Mm. Oh, and then this is a double.
Now, if you were really clever now, so it's you can think ahead of this and think, this tells me where the downpipes will be. It tells me where the toilet soil pipe will be. It tells me where the kitchen wastewater pipe will be.
Knowledge. But doesn't ask sort of thing and how they work.
Yeah, I didn't draw anything behind the garage.
Yeah.
However, I'm still missing some information, aren't I? You can make now. What you've got now, you're at the stage of a theory of what the house looks like. You've gathered information. There's a lot of the speculation has now been overcome. We've pieced things together. There's still some things missing, but we have a very solid theory of what the back of the house might look like. And how will we then move that forward? The only way is to see the back of the house. But we could say things like, well, he's probably got garden furniture out there. He's probably got some patio furniture. He's probably got plants out the back of there. We can talk with confidence about the type of things we might see. And that's the back of my house.
Oh, okay. Oh, there's a door there too.
Yeah.
How did you do?
I think with a pipe.
How did you do? Pluto.
So the kitchen's in the
planet. I talk about this in my book. In the 19th century, Pluto was a mathematical idea that I think it was Charles Lowell suggested that there must be another planet on the outer reaches of the solar system that was causing Uranus, the orbit of Uranus, to kind of wobble. That kind of gravity must be knocking it out. So there was this, it was deemed Planet X. And that's how Pluto started life, as Planet X. And then Charles Tombaugh, through methodical methods, he got photographs of the night sky in about 1915. Huge photographs of the night sky that are mind-bogglingly huge, and millions of dots on them. And he looked at thousands of these images, night after night, month after month, year after year, until he found a tiny dot that had moved. And he went, that's it. And then he proved there was a kind of planet.
It's not.
Then the journey of it was, it was deemed a planet, then it was called something, and then they said, no, this planet couldn't possibly cause Uranus's orbit to change, it's too small, it's not in the right place, so it probably not, it isn't even a planet. Then it changed again when they spotted, got closer, better pictures of it, and then they reclassified it as not a planet. Then it became a dwarf planet, and then culminating in those fantastic, was it Voyager spacecraft photos of Pluto the other year?
Yeah.
And you just saw this most incredible thing, and you thought, how the knowledge has changed over 100 years, and our understanding has changed over 100 years of a kind of theory inside one person's head that started with mathematics, and then it changed into this amazing spectacle. Is for me, is one of the reasons why science is so incredible. And I just wanted to show you how there's loads of exercises like this in the book where you can demonstrate really important innovation in science with a pencil and a piece of paper. Mm. There's nothing in the book that is difficult. There's nothing in the book that requires high skills of drawing. There's nothing in the book that requires children to have high degrees of knowledge. It just helps you to illustrate and understand some of the most amazing principles to how innovation occurs. And I was going to show you this, but I don't have time.
No.
I was mad machine.
But this is a good exercise. This is to look at visualization. You know, you've got Joshua Lederberg, who said, I had to be able to think, what was it like if I was a piece of bacteria? And he had to actually imagine what it would be like. Barbara McClintock did the same thing. And Henry Moore, who picked up a pebble on a beach and thought, oh, that looks like a soldier with one leg. And it became an inspiration for a sculpture. And then saw one of the exercises, which you've got on your desk, you can take it away if you've got it, is a set of mechanical parts. And I give people a crazy task to invent a cloud making machine using those parts.
I have another example. Have you seen the film Lorenzo's Oil?
Yes.
It's 97, I think it was made. And he actually visualized how the enzymes worked. He was not a scientist.
Yes.
But he visualized it and he got the answer in the end.
Absolutely. Yeah. And it's a really powerful tool, Nicole. Tesla used to say he used to play experiments out in his mind, and he didn't need to actually do it. He could play it out in his head and see if it worked. And Einstein, who said he developed theory of relativity by imagining himself riding on a particle of light through space and what would happen to him. Joshua Lederberg, Barbara McClintock are all people who just visualized what it's like to be in a particular environment, what would happen to me. And I've seen science lessons, some wonderfully creative science lessons. You know, I said some loved ones such as design your own cell. I think that's a great lesson, that one. And you know, that a lot of work with alien planets, what would happen if I was on an alien planet and stuff. And I just think that is how you're harnessing the power to be able to visualize as a scientist. And I do hope that you're aware that if all you're doing is imparting knowledge to people, facts and information, and you're not showing people what the potential of what they could do with it is, or giving them any chance to explore it and play with it, even if that's in a lunchtime club or after school, you know, you need to have innovative thinking. And I have mapped your science curriculum, and you are doing some of it already. It is there. I just think it needs to be built on. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.